Good evening to all of you. I bring greetings from my college, university, Manipal Academy of Higher Education, deemed to be the university. Yes, 2 days back was our independence. I bring also greetings. My today's talk is mainly confined on these grounds of introduction, history, epidemiology, etiopathogenesis, types, diagnosis, differential diagnosis, treatment. We'll also have one or two case capsules. So at the end of the talk, you should be able to get away with this message, and I think that is worth. So disease, I think all of you know, caused by Mycobacterium tuberculosis, most common. It's a life-threatening disease. You can see that global burden, almost 12 million. The statistics may change a little bit. As per the WHO report 2013, so you can see that incidence of the tuberculosis globally, and India has definitely the world's largest tuberculosis cases, 26%. Then China, South Africa, we also got Pakistan, Bangladesh, Indonesia, African countries, etc. So, abdominal TB, which I am going to talk, is not all that common as pulmonary TB, but it causes significant morbidity, mortality, and it's a surgeon's topic. So we should have a clear idea about it. Often the diagnosis is delayed, and roughly about 15 to 25% of this abdominal TB, they also have pulmonary tuberculosis. So these are some of the statistical data. Quick one or two slides on history. The reference of the tuberculosis is much more found earlier than European. It's in Vedas. Some mention about Rigveda, it is there. It's called a Yakshma, Atharveda, it's called a Balsa. And also first description of scrofula has been given in Atharveda. 2014, a DNA study was done in Peru, and they found that tuberculosis was existing, almost 6,000 years old disease. So that's what it is. Even if researchers theorized that humans first acquired it in Africa about 5,000 years back. Some description, what Charles Dickens said, that gradual disease. Slowly, a struggle between soul and body, and you see that ultimately it is a waste and withers, and that is still good today. We also call it as phthisis. So I think it's important that all of us should know about this Robert Koch, a German physician and a microbiologist. Not only invented the cause of tuberculosis, but cholera, anthrax also. All of you know about Koch's phenomenon, that you identify organism, you should be able to culture it, then you should be able to inject it, then you should be able to produce the disease. So no wonder he was given a Nobel Prize in physiology, right? So with this background, we'll quickly move on to the epidemiology of abdominal tuberculosis first. The mean age is around 36, so importance of the young population getting affected, preferably sometimes in low socioeconomic group individuals, and more common in males. And today, with the increasing incidence of HIV, there are some risk factors including diabetes, cirrhosis. Malignant patients on treatment, especially tumor necrosis factors, anti-tumor necrosis factors. So these are the people who are vulnerable. And more patients are living with the renal failure on peritoneal dialysis. All this would have precipitated for abdominal tuberculosis. But we should remember a few misconceptions. This we should not have. That abdominal tuberculosis rare, no. Is always associated with active pulmonary tuberculosis, no. It's a disease of the poor man only, no. And once I get treatment, it will not get back TB, no. One should be able to know about the resistance of the organisms, etc. Anytime the old foci may get reactivated, so ingestion of the bacteria or spread from an active pulmonary TB or a part of the miliary TB, can produce acute tubercles, sudden effusion, and produce a miliary tuberculosis with liver, spleen, peritoneum, everything getting involved, right? So it's one of the commonest sites of extrapulmonary tuberculosis and usually caused by Mycobacterium tuberculosis and bovis. Tuberculosis from the chest, swallowing of the bacilli, and bovis, of course, we talked about the milk-related infections, related to much less now, pasteurized milk, etc. So it can affect in the GAT from any this oral end to the anal canal, but these are some of the common sites where it can get affected. I would like you to bring an attention for this Mycobacterium avium complex called MASC. So this is something which you should know that it's a mycobacterium only, but other than tuberculosis, there are a few other organisms. Now this specifically, this happens in immunocompromised individuals, especially patients on HIV. I mentioned about those CKD on dialysis, post-transplant. So this is the one which does not spread from person to person. And this has got a separate treatment. You should know that GAT involvement is actually a part of the disseminated disease. This is the difference between Mycobacterium bovis or tuberculosis and this avium complex. This is a part of the disseminated disease. You can get infiltrates in the liver, spleen, intestines, lymphadenopathy, etc. Patient can come with the pyrex of unknown origin. Everything almost like tuberculosis. Then what is the difference? This important disease is this. See, these are the AFB positive, but gene expert negative. So this is something which you should know today. So that is an important thing you should remember. You should suspect that I'm atypical mycobacteria. And the treatment is also different there. You can see that addition of clarithromycin here. And of course, other things have been mentioned. So as far as the organisms are concerned, we'll remember these three. Mycobacterium bovis and tuberculosis are more common. This avium complex is actually some kind of atypical mycobacteria, occurs in a disseminated tuberculosis, especially in immunocompromised individual, where AFB is positive but gene expert is negative, and a response in addition to rifampicin and ethambutol is for clarithromycin, right? Yes. So how does it spread now? Is it remember four ways and four types? So ingestion of the sputum or a milk, hematogenous, lymphatic, and from direct. So a classical example is a fallopian tube into the peritoneal cavity or from the intestine even to the lymph nodes. Adjacent disease, it's called as. Four types, obviously, lymphadenopathy, peritoneal tuberculosis, visceral, not very common, I'm not discussing that, and intestinal tuberculosis. So simple chart to remember how you ingest the bacilli, all land in a Peyer's patches, we'll talk about it later. Then tubercles are in the submucous plane and caseation happens. Next, it can spread to the lymph node and you get a peritoneal disease as well as lymphatic disease. What a blood spread, same way, again here also, but in addition, there is a solid organ enlargement like lymph node, peritoneum, etc. Now, what about this side? Direct spread from the intestine to the peritoneum. You get ascites there, nodules there, omentum becomes granular. So that's what happens. And lastly, lymphatic spread. Go to the lymph nodes, mesenteric nodes, root of the mesentery. You can even get what's called a cold abscess. Not to confuse that, the nomenclature, they call it a pseudomesenteric cyst. It's nothing to do with the mesenteric cyst nor with the pseudocyst. So it's these are the possible things. So same thing in a little broader way I have mentioned here. So basic problem happens in the Peyer's patches here. Typical ulcers, transverse ulcer, T40, tuberculosis produced transverse ulcer. And anywhere in the body, tuberculosis, when it undergoes fibrosis, is produced stricture, happens in the lungs also and here also. They call it as a napkin stricture. And hyperplastic reaction takes place in the ileocecal region. And that is a chronic granulomatous mass. That is your ileocecal tuberculosis with the mass there. Or a mesenteric nodes. And peritoneal tuberculosis, granular omentum. It can be a generalized ascites, children, failure to thrive, low-grade fever, or it can be loculated with the loops of the bowel and omentum wrapping there. So fluid in between. So that's encysted ascites. There are one or two things about the pathology. Most of us know about everything about pathology, but just want to bring two things. Nowadays, they talk about this toxin, tubercular necrotizing toxin. The one which bacilli releases a toxin, and that causes the death of that macrophage. Obviously, the macrophages are the one which engulf this, and they produce necrosis. So obviously, the host defense will go. They also release some cytokines in the form of these interleukins. And this happens in inflammatory reactions. And it's mentioned that that is one of the causes of the fever in tuberculosis. The release of interleukins. This is what is cytokines. Types are caseation, where there's a lot of extensive caseation surrounded by the epithelioid cells, Langhans type giant cells. Hyperplastic is the one where you get more of a fibrosis, chronic granulomatous reaction forming a mass. And atropic usually seen in elderly patients. They can also have got ascites, but it's not all that severe form. So now comes to the abdominal tuberculosis is broadly classified. Intestinal, this is what we'll be talking today more about that. And this I'm not going to discuss much. Few points I've already told about TB peritonitis. Read about this four times. Nowadays, they don't use the word purulent form. It's basically more sepsis from the female genital tract. The spread is through the fallopian tubes. And lymphadenitis, these are the four things which mentioned. So not all that important there. So the important ones are intestinal tuberculosis. So one of the most favorite question which is asked is why it's common in the ileocecal area, terminal ileum and cecum. So we know that tuberculosis likes those lymphatics. So abundant paste patches. There's alkaline medium. The usually the bacterial contact time is more here. And remember, minimal digestion takes place in the terminal ileum, but maximum absorption. The stasis is mainly due to the valve. That's called ileocecal valve or tulips or tulpius. Few names are there. It's important because there is one sign described not in that name. When this valve doesn't function in tuberculosis because of the stricture or a stenosis. That's why I given those findings. Why ileocecal tuberculosis is common in this area. So with this background of introduction to tuberculosis, now I'll be talking about intestinal tuberculosis. And when we talk about intestine, I would mention definitely few slides on duodenum and colon also, in addition to jejunum and ileum. Postgraduate should know, duodenal involvement is, yes, not all that common. It's a primary involvement is rare. So what I'm trying to tell is, it can be also part of the intestinal tuberculosis itself. Intrinsic or extrinsic, intrinsic again in the form of fibrosis, stricture, and some kind of a dilatation of the second and third part of the duodenum. Or it can be extrinsic in the form of a lymphonodal mass, which may cause a compression. So this is a duodenal tuberculosis. And as usual, you can do ultrasound scans. Endoscopy may show dilated duodenum, barium study also, no problem. The one which is mimicker here is the superior mesenteric arterial syndrome. And obviously, if you are able to get the biopsy, it will solve the problem. And this again, the sign has been described. This has been described for many. So don't confuse this. String sign is basically a narrow. It's also mentioned for Crohn's disease. We'll talk about it. So duodenal tuberculosis basically affecting the second, third part, etc. So it causes the stricture and obstruction. Now jejunum and ileum, we already know about the most common site, terminal ileum and ileocecal junction. Very often a patient may be having an ileal stricture. He also may be having a small stricture at the ileocecal opening in near the cecum. One should be carefully examine that area, right? Remember one thing, there are three important causes of perforation of in GIT here in the ileum. especially. All those are three. First is typhoid fever. Second is tuberculosis. And third, remember, trauma. So whenever a patient comes with the ileal perforation, these things should be considered first. Then you can think of any other diagnosis. And as usual, caseal necrosis remains the important finding for a diagnosis. Now, what about colorectal tuberculosis? I am not talking about the anal fistulae caused by tuberculosis, etc. Basically, it is not common, but right colon is more commonly involved than the left colon. That is what you should remember. It can be cecum continuity to the ascending colon, or maybe a skip into the transverse colon, or maybe left colon. But just you to remember one thing, incidence decreases as you go to the left. So if at all you have a problem in the right side colon, bet on tuberculosis. If you have a problem on the left colon, even in a young, bet on carcinoma. This is the basic dictum. Then of course the biopsy will tell. Multifocal involvement is known. What is the significance of that? As you know, synchronous carcinoma colon is also known. Similarly, tuberculosis. So if you open a patient who has got, you have done a colonoscopy, and let us say you have picked up a lesion in the transverse colon, biopsy has come as tuberculosis, you plan for a tuberculosis resection of the transverse colon, but please examine the colon, because I mentioned to you, cecum ascending colon, there may be another stricture. And if you do only one resection anastomosis, there may be a problem. So it's important. That is what is multifocal involvement is not all that uncommon in tuberculosis. So remember, especially in a colorectal tuberculosis like carcinoma colon. So with this background now, we'll talk only about intestinal tuberculosis. So this is what I already mentioned to you. Just remember ulcerative and hyperplastic, it can be a mixed. That itself is the full percentage there. Some people put the word Koenig syndrome for intestinal tuberculosis. Both are not same. The German surgeon who described it, tuberculosis is one of the causes for Koenig syndrome. It's basically that ileocecal valve syndrome. You know that whatever the stenosis, the opening of the ileum into the cecum, there's a valve syndrome. So it doesn't function. So some kind of a gaseous distension, diarrhea, incomplete obstruction. You get confused to Crohn's, confused to tuberculosis. So it may turn out to be neither tuberculosis nor Crohn's. So this is called a Koenig syndrome. If you are asked, tuberculosis is one of the differential diagnoses. Both are not synonymous or same. So what does it do? Once it goes to the terminal ileum in the form of initial part is enteritis, like any other diarrhea, increased peristalsis, increased stone, some abdominal pain. Then you get transverse ulcers. The healing of this, because the lymphatics run around like that, and the ultimate reaction is producing a stricture. So this kind of a stricture or a stenosis can be multiple. In between can be dilated segments, and later stage, of course, the matting. A cocoon formation can happen there, basically a membrane-like thing, and go for obstruction. So in a nutshell, it's a lymphangitis, endarteritis, granuloma, caseous necrosis, ulceration, scarring, obstruction, or ulceration with a perforation causing peritonitis. So this is a ulcerative variety, right? So with this, we'll move on to signs and symptoms of ileocecal tuberculosis. So we can broadly classify so that you will not miss. What are the symptoms due to ulceroconstrictive? Obviously, basically a diarrhea. You can see that some percentage there. Distension, colics. So that's what typically patient complains of colics. What do you mean by adjacent tissue involvement? Ascites, lymph node, tubo-ovarian symptoms in a female. So what do you mean by constitutional? Fever, fatigue, weight loss, night sweats, and a mass in the right leg fossa. Because of the, again, I mentioned to you, hyperplastic individual with a chronic granulomatous reaction, right? So this is how broadly you classify ulceroconstrictive, adjacent tissue, constitutional symptom, and a mass. But common incidences wise, if you look at that broadly, fever with the night sweats, diarrhea, hyperproteinemia, pedal edema, that's because of the severe hyperproteinemia, distension, lump, etc. One of the commonest question which is asked, and several people giving several explanations, so I thought I should tell that. Fever with the night sweat, what is the common cause? Usually happens in the evening raise of temperature, right? So just normal body temperature itself is reasonably increased in the at night. There is attention of the patient, you know, he's not doing anything, he's in a closed room. Morning time, he'll be going here and there doing his work. He may be drinking water, whatever it is. Also remember, our immune system gets activated relatively late in the night also. So immune system is the one which produces, I mentioned to you earlier about those interleukins 1, 6, etc. There is also a cortisol and adrenal levels are a little bit lowered during the night time. So various explanation mentioned for a fever with the night sweats in tuberculosis. I hope it is clear. If this patient comes with obstruction, I think all of you know how to diagnose an obstruction. When you palpate, the bowel which is distended also give a tenderness. Tenderness not necessarily a sign of gangrene. Also can be a distended stretch, you know, too much big loops of bowel. A Davy feel without fluid, exudative fluid with the loops of bowel, a mass, a stepladder peristalsis possible, or even a patient can have signs of peritonitis in case if there is a gangrene or a perforation. So you broadly divide if there is an obstruction. What are the evidence of dehydration? I think this is for postgraduates. So that's what you are going to have, this pulse, low urine output, etc. Look at the tummy there for any prominent loops there. And tympanic node. You may be lucky sometimes to get a stepladder peristalsis. And hernial orifices always to be mentioned in all cases of acute intestinal obstruction. I mentioned to you sometimes that I think some other class, when you have an obstruction, especially tuberculosis, that ascites is the part which can also make a little bit of patent process of vaginalis patent and can produce a hernia. So hernia is a, not a disease, hernia is a manifestation of a disease. Recent development of hernia. So you may blame it to a hernia, but it can be due to tuberculosis or any other matter. So just keep it in mind. And so I think you can see that watch carefully for a, you can't get a 100% stepladder peristalsis, but just look at that. I'll tell about this patient. This patient had an ileal stricture and he underwent a laparotomy and they did a laparotomy and they did a dissection and anastomosis. And you can see the healed scar there. And maybe that is the time patient was not taking much in the hospital, did not develop obstruction. He goes home and comes back with obstruction. So you can see that picture. And you know, it continued to have obstruction with stepladder. And we had to explore him. And we found that again the cecum was the target there. Initial surgeon has done only an ileal stricture resection anastomosis. He felt the cecum. He thought there is no problem in the cecum. It left. Probably there was a stenosis at the ileocecal valve. So it's important that, you know, these things can happen. So when you open the abdomen for tuberculosis, even if there's an ileal stricture, you, before deciding on ileal stricture resection, have a thorough examination of the cecum, ascending colon. Yes, if you are able to get a colonoscopy done and a thorough examination, probably this would have solved that issue. Often, every hospital may not have the facility of a colonoscopy and putting the scope into the terminal ileum. Might have been missed. So keep it in mind whenever you have tuberculosis multifocal. I mentioned also in the colon, also in the ileum. So these are some of the pictures of distended loop. The same patient here you can see. Is a mass sometime, hypoproteinemia, distension of the abdomen. These are some of the various pictures. Ancystic ascites. This is that mass. Look at that small tubercles on the surface is on table, thickened tubercle, and you can see the narrow stricture there. So these are some of the things which commonly they ask you. What is the mass due to for postgraduates? Whenever in tuberculosis, when you get a mass, when you describe, what is it due to? Tympanatic gurgle means it's more of a matted loops. Granular omentum, generally seen in children, but it is possible here also. Mesenteric nodal mass, hyperplastic cecum typical in the right iliac fossa, or it could be a loculated ascites. So these are the few important differential diagnosis when you get a mass in the abdomen. So chart is big, but doesn't matter. The most important thing I mentioned to differentiate ulcerative one from hyperplastic. So more from a tubercular mycobacterium, virulent organism, typical ulcers you get, they heal with either a stricture or perforate, and that gives rise to, ultimately stricture can give rise to intestinal obstruction. And hyperplastic is the one, can be both bovis as well as tuberculosis, low grade infection, chronic granulomatous mass in the right iliac fossa, which is due to thickened cecum, and that is a typical of a mass which is mobile with little highly placed cecum. So that is cecum. So with this, we'll quickly go on to the differential diagnosis. So you know how to make a diagnosis of tuberculosis now, ulcerative and hyperplastic, you know, clinical diagnosis and on palpation finding, and we'll go to differential diagnosis. See here, if you have got a patient who has come very early diarrhea, it goes more for evaluation. Generally a physician will, or a gastroenterologist, because you have to keep it in mind the differential diagnosis of diarrhea, including here comes the Crohn's disease, maybe typhoiditis. So many diseases are there, non-specific colitis and enteritis. So I think I'll not go into the details about that. But as far as we are concerned, we should be aware that tuberculosis can produce, this is the picture. But when the patient comes with a mass in the right iliac fossa, which is classically from Europe angle, so many differential diagnoses are given in the book. There's no point in wasting the time. Your case is important. Talk about your patient, and if there is a mass, little highly placed, firm to irregular, having some mobility, constitutional, especially night sweats. I mentioned to you why. Weight loss may be there, anemia, etc. You give a diagnosis of tuberculosis, but carcinoma of the cecum, more common in women, little more elderly. Again, it can be missed because the scopes may not reach there. People have been treated as tuberculosis also and turned out to be a carcinoma cecum. So it is important. So firm to hard swelling with the restricted mobility, you give a diagnosis of carcinoma. I will not discuss much about amoeboma because once in a while, gurgle, right iliac fossa, tender mass can be an amoeboma. Nowadays, incidence is much less. Patient may have a chronic diarrhea, traveler. These are the details. And Crohn's, of course, not that you don't get in India, but that kind of a well-defined borders, that consistency of firm and all you won't get. They are more of a loops of the bowel. You are matted loops like thing you are palpating in the Crohn's disease, and more tenderness you get. So, but when the patient comes as ascites, some three or four differential diagnosis given. So you have to keep it in mind, your patient has got diarrhea as a prominent complaint. Think in that way. Crohn's will take an upper hand. Please remember. When a patient has got a mass, there's a few differential diagnoses. When a patient has ascites, these are the few differential diagnoses of a patient who has come to you for a possible abdominal tuberculosis, right? So these are the diagnoses. So from the postgraduate angle, one of the common question which is asked is that differentiation, no? So you have a tuberculosis mycobacterium here, transverse ulcer I mentioned, and fever, etc., etc. As Crohn's disease, I think you know that diarrhea is a main complaint, cryptabscesses and transmural inflammation. very characteristic. Relapses, skip areas, skip, very common in Crohn's disease, because you may open the abdomen, you should be able to know, I am dealing with the tuberculosis or I am dealing with the Crohn's. Suppose patient has come with obstruction and you are, did not do histological diagnosis, so that you should be able to come to reasonable conclusion. A lot of the creepy fat, you can call it as transfer inflammation, cryptabsyssis. So these are all the cryptabsyssis is a microscopic finding, but on table findings, you should be roughly to have an idea whether it is tuberculosis or a Crohn's disease. So just only one or two to highlight. Diarrhea is extremely common in Crohn's. You see here, 73 ITB is nothing but intestinal tuberculosis. So this is very low. Now what about night sweat? So see the p-value also. And perianal disease is much more common in Crohn's disease. So diarrhea, perianal disease, a vague mass, tender mass, more for a Crohn's disease compared to tuberculosis. Again, from Weller, the paper. So just to give some ideas about, again, fever here, look at the intestinal tuberculosis, 68 patients. But altered bowel habits, you see here Crohn's. Then, of course, pulmonary involvement, abdominal distension. But look at the other column here. Recurrent obstructions are more common in Crohn's disease compared to tuberculosis. So these are some of the important points you should know when you are dealing with the tuberculosis or a Crohn's disease, right? Again, few important points we already mentioned. Duration, I mean, longer duration, obviously, tuberculosis compared to short duration of a Crohn's disease, and some of the symptoms we already discussed. They may ask you, what is Ponset's disease? It's a polyarthritis affecting patients with the tuberculosis, with especially extra pulmonary tuberculosis, including intestinal tuberculosis. Maybe associated with the erythema nodosum. So these are the few important things you should know when you are handling the tuberculosis patients, right? So, if any questions are there up to now, starting from the etiology, pathology, clinical features up to now, because now onwards we'll take on to the investigation. You can ask one or two questions, whatever I know, I'll take it. So we will go to the, looks like no questions, no problem. So it's simple one. So we'll go down to the diagnosis and investigation. So again, you classify. See there, diagnosis by laboratory on one side, radiology, histology. So these are the things, the way in which if you classify, you will not miss. Think that you are seeing the patient in the outpatient department. What is the first thing you send? You send for blood examinations, including ESR, albumin you may send. Then you send for radiology for a chest X-ray. And you find some other investigations. Radiology, when I said imaging also. You'll get an ultrasound. Then, of course, CT scan. But more importantly, you should always make an attempt to get a tissue diagnosis. This is important here. I will come to that, each one of them. So lymphocyte count, sputum AFB, these are the few important investigations which you send in tuberculosis. So one important thing, all of you know that raised ESR, which is more of a prognostic value. There's nothing like a cutoff or et cetera here, more than 50, 75. So, but raised ESR has got more importance as far as the prognostic part is concerned, recovery after the ATT. We need two important things for the wound healing and anastomotic healing. Anemia and albumin, two important things before surgery. So if the patient has got severe hypoproteinemia, you have got a time better to correct it. and you would have assessed by midarm circumference or triceps fold thickness, pedal edema, all those things, protein levels. So liver function tests are also important here. One thing, remember I mentioned to you about that atypical mycobacteria, AVM complex. It can give rise to altered LFT, including increased alkaline phosphatase and some kind of a granulomas in the liver. So that is possible in atypical bacterial infections. Otherwise, in intestinal tuberculosis, you may not find a great change. But we need for rifampicin, we may need for hepatotoxicity caused by the ATT. So we need to have a liver function test. This for postgraduate sake, in a peripheral smear, what are these cells? These are the basically called TREX, T regulator cells. These are the ones which get stimulated once that mycobacterium tuberculosis infection happens. And they have been measured also in the peripheral smear. And if they are low, means they are basically, they are losing battle, like you can, in a simple word. These are the points which help them to differentiate from tuberculosis versus Crohn's. This has been found to be one of the useful investigation. This is the, for the sake of postgraduates, I have brought this. But please don't tell this, you know, in your practical examination for some reason. You can write this in a theory paper, right? So then you do, every patient you do ultrasound, and again it's a extended arm of a surgeon. So you send the patient, you find thickened cecum or loops of the bowel. Ascites is there, means always remember it's a ultrasound guided aspiration. Always you put a needle and aspirate. There can be a focal ascites, that's called a club sandwich sign, mesenteric node enlargement. Retroperitoneal node enlargement is not all that common in tuberculosis. If you are more serious about that, it can go for a lymphoma actually, rather than tuberculosis. And a few, these are the findings in ultrasound. But as you know, once you have the fluid, typically you aspirate, that's exudate with the more proteins there. LDH is also more, it indicates a more activity, you know. White cell counts are also more there. Bacterial isolation culture is possible, but remember it will take some time, and results are, you can see the percentage there. There's also SAG, which is commonly done, is a gradient. G for gradient there, there's a serum and ascitic fluid, albumin gradient. So all these things can be done, but they are only indirectly, they may suggest this could be tuberculosis. None of them will give a diagnosis. In the initial evaluation of any patient who comes to the department, you don't know it is tuberculosis. It can be something else. So this is the protocol. This is how you do this. You do ultrasound, you go and fluid, you aspirate, send in for, these are the things. There is also, you do this increased adenosine deaminase called ADA levels. So they also compared, just like a SAG here, serum ADA and to ascitic fluid ADA. And if it is more than 0.98, they are suggestive of tuberculosis. Suggestive, again, I use the word suggestive. So it, not only SAG now, it is now ADA levels compared to serum as well as ascites. Right. What else? Level of the interferon Y. They are also elevated in a tubercular ascites. Sensitivity of the specificity again increased, combining ascitic fluid, ADA, and interferon. So these are the few things which you should know in patients who have got tuberculosis. As I mentioned to you, ultrasound is subjective, but so much information it can give. But CCT is obviously more objective. So many details can be made out, especially for the pelvis. Wherever there's a lot of ascites, gas is there. So there may be some difficulty, but so much information it can give rise to. Solid masses, you can even diagnose with the CCT scan, and percutaneous biopsy has been recommended, but it's not a first line of answer from you. If a tuberculosis is suspected, if you can able to prove by other diagnosis, percutaneous biopsy for the whole of viscous is not recommended, right? So you can see the enhancement there. So dilated lobes, collapsed bowel. So the sensitivity increases if there's a total obstruction. Otherwise, a partial obstruction, it may be difficult to differentiate it from a Crohn's or tuberculosis. This is some of the things. Can you see here? Look at the bowel there. This is a kind of a, that's what I called in the initial part as a membrane. A membrane which is covering the intestinal loops called abdominal cocoon. This is straightforward ascites. And this is splenic multiple abscesses due to tuberculosis. Of course, part of the, it was a miliary tuberculosis. So these are the more information it can give rise to, can be got from the CT scan. But more importantly, a CT scan, especially in the Western literature, you find it should help in differentiating Crohn's. See, these are the patients who come in early with the diarrhea evaluation and what has been called as two signs here. One is a fatty halo sign. Another is a comb sign, you know, like a comb, right? So that's the mesenteric, you know, standing there. So these are the few signs which they have described for a Crohn's. Can you see this comb pattern? These are the hypervascular appearance of the mesentery. But I mentioned too, in the earlier part, it's fatty. At surgery, sometimes we call it the fatty creeping. So this is the CCG scan finding in a Crohn's disease called as a comb sign. So if on table tuberculosis, so before surgery, if you have done a CT scan, you have got some points for Crohn's more than tuberculosis and you opened. So this is how you should apply your practical knowledge when you open the abdomen for suspected case of a intestinal obstruction, tuberculosis versus Crohn's. Some of the findings they have given here. Strictures concentric in tuberculosis, they are eccentric here. Of course, the nodes, if you find caseation, it is a hallmark of tuberculosis. And in Crohn's, you will not get there. These are the few important findings of difference. And still you are not happy with that CT scan, you can do a CT enterography. And there are some signs again, comb signs can be made out here, and strictures, stenosis. So by and large, small bowel enteroscopy is more difficult. Small bowel enteroscopy, I'm talking about small bowel enteroscopy. Not many places have the facility for a small bowel enteroscopy. So it's better that CT enterography will be able to get the suspicion of tuberculosis or Crohn's disease. Histological diagnosis, if you are able to get from sputum AFB positive, nothing like that. If there's an active PT, bronchoscopic washings, bronchoscopic biopsy, if it comes as tuberculosis, you don't have to proceed to other diagnosis. But in a patient, you have got time now, electives, best is to do a colonoscopy and you can do a biopsy. You can see a larger ulcer, the granulation tissue there. A biopsy can be very well taken from here and it will also tell the luminal narrowing. So it's important that multiple strictures are less likely to respond to ATT than a single stricture. Why I say this? Because sometimes you have a doubt. Case of a intestinal tuberculosis diagnosed with the ATT, partial obstruction is there. Should we continue ATT or should we go ahead with the resection? So these are the some important documentation required when you do a colonoscopy, multiple strictures. So they respond to ATT much less compared to single stricture. As I mentioned to you, it's whatever possible, you should be able to get a tissue diagnosis and from the tuberculosis. So what are the endoscopy findings in a Crohn's disease are totally different. Look at that aphthous ulcer here. large ulcer, linear ulcer, aphthous ulcer, cobblestone reticulation, and a stricture. So these are the typical of a Crohn's disease. So tuberculosis and the Crohn's, it should be parallelly studied so that you'll know the difference. So when it comes to histopathological diagnosis today, I think all of you know about CBNAT. I have a slide there. Whatever tissue which you take from the tuberculosis, it has to be sent for a cartridge-based nucleic acid amplification. Today it is mandatory that every patient you should do the GeneXpert or CBNAT, and it also helps with the diagnosis as well as to know the rifampicin resistance. So apart from the KJ necrosis and all that, whatever you know that, so we have to get a CBNAT here. See, the yield of the organism on smear culture may be low, whatever you take from the colonoscopic biopsy, etc. A positive culture is seen only in 20% of the patients. So we can't depend upon that here. So every nucleic acid amplification test of CBNAT is the gold standard today in a tuberculosis, or is it international health? So the diagnosis of extrapulmonary tuberculosis, GeneXpert should be your diagnosis, and the test has to be done in all patients with the Mycobacterium tuberculosis. I mentioned only for cases you have done a barium, what are the findings, so many things they have mentioned there. Fleischner sign or inverted umbrella sign. I mentioned to you sometimes about the valve, no? So thickening of the clips of the ileocecal valve with the wide gaping of the valve. This is something you don't go for deformity in urinary bladder and a golf hole ureter gaping, like, so same thing here also. That's what is the Koenig syndrome, that's what I mentioned to you earlier. So these are few findings mentioned in the barium study, because these are some of the standard postgraduate questions of pulled up cecum. You can see here, look at that ileum there, this angle, acute angle become obtuse. This is a classical of a tuberculosis, right? So again, some stenosis called a purse string stenosis. Can you see the cocoon here in a barium? This is abdominal cocoon. So these are the two signs which are described also. Fibrotic terminal ileum opening into the contracted cecum called a Sterling sign. And the second picture is also abdominal cocoon. What about Crohn's disease? I mentioned about the cobblestone reticulation, and what is this? See, that's the picture, all filling defects like, and this is, look at long segment. This you don't get in tuberculosis, such a long segment causing a stricture. This is typical of a Crohn's string sign of canter. So longer segment, linear ulcer, longitudinal ulcer, deeper ulcers, transmembrane inflammation, they're all typical of a Crohn's disease, longer one. Tuberculosis strictures or stenosis may be short, but you can also get in a jejunum, ileum, etc. But in general, these are some of the points which will help you in differentiating. So is that what in every patient who comes with the tuberculosis, you will you do all these tests, priorities, obstruction, resuscitation. You do a plain X-ray ultrasound, patient is not having tenderness, I mentioned subacute. You can do a colonoscopic biopsy, I mentioned if possible, because if it is positive, you can always try ATT without surgery. But on ATT, if there is a worsening, then obviously it requires a surgery. So that is something which you should know. So when you take a plain X-ray in abdomen, multiple gas fluid levels, and this 2 to 4 means this can be abnormal renal obstruction, and pneumatosis refers obviously gangrene and air in the well wall. So this supine picture showing the distal limit, and these are the typical multiple gas fluid levels and valvulae conventis. I don't know whether you can see there. And so that's a interstitial obstruction. Few images. That's a multiple gas fluid level. Our case of a enterocolitis, initial part, we have done few cases enterocolitis. Enterocolitis. So it's also called a small bowel anemia. Small. This is the colonoscopy. And last but not the least, I mentioned to you, when in doubt, you got ascites, patient not in obstruction, you are confused, ADA done, SARG done, chest x-ray, diagnostic laparoscopy, and a biopsy. It may give a diagnosis because you can, it's not just ascitic fluid aspiration, peritoneal nodules, omental nodules, there will be nodules over the falciform ligament, peritoneal cavity, you can have a look at the pelvis, tubes in a female. So you may be able to get a diagnosis. In many cases, I have myself have done a diagnostic laparoscopy and able to get a diagnosis for a patient who was getting evaluated by physicians or a gastroenterologist for a suspected case of intestinal tuberculosis. So you should be able to get a diagnosis. So can I ask one of the candidates? It's a very simple before we start the treatment part of it. So a case capsule, can one of the postgraduates just read the whatever I have written there, just an interesting case. Hello.
Okay, sir. 31-year-old male.
Yeah, please.
Case capsule one.
Go ahead. I am listening to you. Speak a little more loudly, closer to the mic. Okay. I can't hear you. Sound problem.
Case of abdominal pain obstruction. 31-year-old male with no comorbidity. Presented with pain abdomen since 1 week. Incidence and onset, diffuse lower abdominal pain, colicky, vomiting 6 times, associated with distension since 2 days, not past latest and stool since 1 day.
I just want to ask you quickly, 31-year-old, think of that, no comorbidity. Can you think of 2-3 diagnoses in a young patient for intestinal obstruction? What do you suspect?
Could be appendicular mass.
Appendicular mass, please do not consider as a differential diagnosis for a abdominal obstruction. Okay, intestinal obstruction. Okay, it doesn't produce intestinal obstruction. I think that is no fever at all. So think of common things. You say stricture tuberculosis, fine. Tuberculosis stricture, no problem. You need not have comorbidity. Any other possibility, young child? For tuberculosis, now for the time being, you get rid of that. One diagnosis I've already given you, tuberculosis. If this patient comes to casualty, what are things you suspect? Yes. All right. I will give a, because of the young patient, obstructed hernia, mentioned, you know. So you should rule out an obstructed hernia. You should rule out bands, congenital bands may be there, adhesions may be there. So these are the things which you should first consider. All right, no problem, we'll proceed. Yeah, can you read now?
Yes, sir. So these are the findings and plain extra abdomen. So there's no other positive history. Patient is conscious, oriented, no pallor, rictal sinuses, clubbing, or generalized lymphadenopathy. Pulse rate is 70 beats per minute, BP is 110 by 70. Respiratory rate is 22 cycles per minute, and patient is erythritis. On abdomen examination, abdomen is distended, tympanic node, and a vague mass is palpable.
Can you read that x-ray?
Yes, sir. This is a plain abdomen erect X-ray. Showing a gastric bubble separately, more black, and my air fluid levels are only one I can see in the right left hypochondric region, sir. One air fluid level.
You can see here, but can you see this some kind of thing here? Can you see? Is it common to get it like that?
Right? Yes, sir. A line continues from left, right inlet fossa goes up. Yes, sir. Till left hypochondrium and then comes down in left inlet fossa, following the colon margin. Maybe.
Ultrasound could not give much information. So we asked for a CT scan. Can you read the CT scan findings? CT scan findings.
Yes, sir. So abdomen, per abdomen distension was present. So 3x3 cm mass was palpable in right and left fossa, and mild tenderness was also present. And bowel sounds were normal. CCT findings showed few dilated jejunal bowel loop with transition point in the right and left fossa and umbilical region, forming a closed loop obstruction. Possibility of internal hernia to be considered. Query. Transmesenteric. About 60 cm of ileum is covered by membrane separated with difficulty by 3 cm. No disease. About 60 cm of ileum is covered by membrane.
I just want to show you. This is our laparotomy we did, and this is that. See the intestinal loops, we could not take it out. Second picture, few you can see, few. Here few cannot be separated. This is what is the membrane, right? So what do you think probably diagnosis?
So this is abdominal cocoon, sir.
So one is abdominal cocoon. Does it look like tuberculosis? So the point which I am trying to tell is the reason why I got this is only for this abdominal cocoon. When I said everybody writes only about tuberculosis, you should know that tuberculosis is not only the cause. Abdominal cocoon can be due to low grade peritoneal infection, whatever be the reason. Today you see more of because of SLE, continuous ambulatory peritoneal dialysis, Levin shunts, Practolol, iodine, etc. Originally mentioned as retrograde menstruation being the cause. That theory is not all that good now. But still, the infection from the female genital tract, retrograde infection also can be responsible rather than retrograde menstruation. So when abdominal cocoon is asked to you, you should be able to say not only tuberculosis, these are the causes. Because this is one mistake you should not do. And ultimately, biopsy report came as non-specific. You can't say that pathologist, you are at fault. No, no, it is tuberculosis. You look at it carefully, laparotomy done, no ascites at all, no tubercles at all. And you look at carefully what I have told in the 31-year male, no comorbidity. So in other words, no fever, nothing. So clinical examination is still important. Proper history taking, come to the diagnosis. Sometimes difficult to separate this membrane. You may have to take the segment of the intestine out. So cocoons can be confused as only tuberculosis. So tuberculosis is not the only one cause. So that is the purpose of putting this. Yes. I hope it's clear. Now we'll proceed to the treatment. Everyone knows about tuberculosis treatment, so I'm not going to discuss much about it. Other that, standard is a 2 months regime of 4 drugs and 4 months regime of 3 drugs. So it's a rifampicin, INH, pyrazinamide, ethambutol, rifampicin, about 10 milligrams per kg body weight. INH, about 6 milligrams per kg body weight. Pyrazinamide, you give about 500 milligrams three times a day. And ethambutol, 25 milligrams per kg body weight. In the second, that's the 4 months of three drug, pyrazinamide is not given. That's all. All cases of intestinal or abdominal, standard recommendation is 6 months. But in intestine and maybe in orthopedic cases, there is a little bit of relaxation in the sense it is left to the treating clinician. 2 or 3 months, he can give extension because especially orthopedicians give for 1 year also. So that is what is important. But remember, the rifampicin resistance, I have already told you, that's why I put it here again, CBNAT all the time. So this is the one test which you should be doing in all patients, which will check your rifampicin resistance. So these are the anti-tuberculous drugs. As postgraduates, you know, two important things I will tell. Doing surgery, resection, anastomosis, anybody can do. But remember the nutrition I mentioned to you. If possible, including a total parenteral nutrition, supplementation of the albumin few days before. And again, if you are able to get a tuberculosis diagnosis, you can start ADT and then take the patient for surgery, even if you are you are convinced that this patient requires surgery. Still better. Always elective surgery is better than emergency. You encounter a single stricture, do a strictureplasty or a multiple stricture resection anastomosis. I mentioned to you that when you take out a intestinal loop terminal ileum, it's better that you check the patency of the distal intestine to check any one more narrowing is there near the cecum, ileocecal junction. Because any suspicion of that, it will go for a limited collection. So this has to be kept in mind. Sometimes you find a matted loops and obstruction, you can't do resection. Yes, get it for a bypass surgery. Because tuberculosis is one disease where you cannot say this patient, I am going to do only this. Inside the abdomen, there can be a lot of issues. Starting from adhesions, you should not try to do a multiple enterotomies, etc. Earlier, we have done also a few cases, just landed with open and close and started ATT and patient showed improvement. Just took a small piece of biopsy and it came as positive. So these are the various possibilities. You should keep it in mind and explain to the patient before you start the surgery. This is what is required. I may not be able to do anything if I see a plastered bowel. So what are the important precautions other than the nutritional part, fitness for surgery, total parenteral nutrition in case if there's vomiting, correction of the albumin, these are the basic things. So preferred is a midline incision. And these are some of the principles of acute abdomen when you open. In tuberculosis especially, a lot of adhesions may be there. Carefully release them. During releasing of the adhesions, doesn't matter, a little tissue is on the bowel surface. Doesn't matter. But don't do other way. What I mean to say other way is, don't have the bowel surface with you means you have caused an enterotomy or taken the piece of the bowel. Hands must divide. Carefully open the peritoneum. Otherwise, this is to avoid the fistula. Fluid has to be collected and sent for that all the tests. Explore the abdomen. You may have a duodenal tuberculosis. You would have got it from the CT scan, etc. But still, on table. Look from all the strictures. See what are the segment is dilated, not dilated. Ascending colon is dilated means the problem may be the colon, transverse colon. So every important part you should examine. And any doubt of gangrene means vascularity, you know how to check for that, pink peristalsis, etc. So a single stricture, you can do a strictureplasty like a pyloriplasty, longitudinal incision, closure vertical. I mentioned to you, look into this ileocecal opening. Look at that matted loops here. Difficult to even take it out. We have not done anything in this patient. Started the patient, ATT improved with the biopsy. Some of the bands you divide. So you know how to make a diagnosis. The cecum will be collapsed in multi cases like this. Look at that massive dilated loops. This is the stricture. So do a resection, anastomosis. The bowel disparity is there. Give a chital cut. Limited colectomy. A mass here. You can see a mass there. So ileocecal anastomosis, ileoascending colon. You can do a nice mobilization of the ascending colon. Easily it's an avascular plane on the lateral side and inferior to the cecum as well as the terminal ileum. And you can do a ileocolic anastomosis. Few pictures. You can see here multiple peritoneal nodules, some adhesions here, some kind of a plastered cocoon like. See here, the limited colectomy, single stricture. So, patient has come with acute obstruction. Your aim is resuscitation, nasogastric tube, and no invasive investigation now. Don't try to do a colon open, put in a lot of gas and cause obstruction. CT scan can be done and take a patient for emergency laparotomy. Treat accordingly. Principle of the obstruction case will not change just because patient is suspect tuberculosis. No. Fluid resuscitation, electrolytes, laparotomy, because releasing the obstruction is ultimate. Before it goes of a perforation, patient may be already in hypovolemic shock. So that has to be taken the priority. So this is what you should do. The question that sometimes which is asked is whether can we do primary anastomosis after resection in acute obstruction? Yes. This is a common on the right side. If you feel there is a vascularity is not affected, you can always suspicious cases, you ask the patient, anesthetist to, you know, wrap that bowel, to give oxygen, and you wrap the bowel, and 100% oxygen is given. So look for improvement, and primary anastomosis can always be done. There's some papers, you can, percentage of anastomotic leak, you see here 0%. But if your patient in acute obstruction has got low levels of albumin, 2.2, 2, etc., hemoglobin is 8 grams, you have opened, you find edema of the cut edges because there is a delayed presentation, doubtful vascularity, tension, any one of the situation, and if your patient has come late with the perforation and shock, he has not come in the golden hour. He has come after 24 hours, 48 hours. It's better to avoid anastomosis as well. Get ready for a exteriorization. You can do a resection and make one proximal loop here out and distal is here. And only thing is, yes, patient requires a second surgery. Skin closure, if you have got a bad contamination, don't do. You just put a stitch there and keep it. You can tie it after 2-3 days to prevent the wound infection. Their principles are all same, like how you give a wash, etc. Yes, you give anti-tuberculosis treatment for 6 months and surgery, you look for anastomotic leak. Can you see here? Fecal fistula. Yes, an attempt to close in presence of a perforation. This given way, and always follow period. You always look at the drug compliance, whether the patient is taking or not. Weight gain, general improvement, fever disappears, ESR improves. I think all of you know how to take out that. So toxicity, I think every postgraduate, everyone should know the drugs, side effects and treatment. these are some of our patients. Not much thing other than to say the various types of surgery. One should be ready. Resection, hemicolectomy, limited. A case was having two. There was a narrow of the duodenum for which we have to do duodenogenostomy. One was ileal transverse without resection. That's what I meant by bypass. Closed loop becomes more here. One was an abscess drainage, and early we done nothing, open and closed with small biopsy. So that has to be told. Biopsies you can take from various sites. I mentioned this only to tell you it's possible to get a biopsy diagnosis. In case, always remember CBNAT in all these patients, in some form you should attempt to get a biopsy. For all that matter, reference is given for evaluation. You thoroughly examine, you may find some node here, axilla. You take a biopsy, it comes as tuberculosis. So get ready for that, even if it's a case of intestinal or abdominal tuberculosis. These images, I think, you've already seen. So before I conclude, I have one more capsule. Dr. Radhakrishna, I have 5-10 minutes. Is it okay?
Carry on, sir. You have enough time. Not a problem.
So one postgraduate, please get ready. If you have, okay, any questions you've got, please ask now. Related to intestinal tuberculosis, I'll take this case capsule and conclude. So please, one of you, get ready for presentation.
And Dr. Ketan, you have a question?
Yeah. Hello, good evening, Dr. Shenoy. How are you?
I'm okay, sir. Hello, sir. Good evening.
Yeah, your presentation is excellent. Figures are too good. There's only one issue based on my personal experience with abdominal TB is the duration of AKT.
Definitely.
Yeah, because many a times, 6 months or AKT, the doughiness and that lumpiness doesn't disappear. So I think extending it to the traditional 9 months at times is little safer and better. So you have complete resolution of that lumpiness or fullness in the abdomen.
Yes, sir. I have, while presenting, I have mentioned in case of intestinal tuberculosis and in bone tuberculosis. Bone tuberculosis.
Yeah.
Beyond 6 months, it is mentioned, but left to the treating physician or a surgeon. Because the World Health Organization recommendation, because I inquired through my pulmonary tuberculosis specialist friend in our hospital about this issue. They say 6 months. Maybe in Indian scenario, we get more advanced patients.
Exactly.
Presentation.
Yeah.
It is left to the treating person. I fully agree with you. I also give for 9 months.
Exactly.
I give for 9 months. But for... postgraduate, sometimes the recommendations are... Dr. Radhakrishna.
Yes, sir.
I thought whether you can clarify this tuberculosis ATT treatment for a surgeon, 6 months or 9 months?
No, actually, there is no consensus because, first of all, I don't do the medication myself. Some patients respond very well. The regime is done by a gastroenterologist. Some patients they give for six months and some for 9 months. I can't tell which ones for what, but effectively, minimum of 6 months, and sometimes they go on till 9 months. Actually, what happens, a large number of these patients have issues the liver dysfunction, etc. And that's the time when they need to change second-line drugs, and that's when they'll get sort of delayed. But very few patients just respond to a good six-month course. But by and large, that is the minimum. But I mean, I don't know what are the criteria for which they select 6 and 9 months.
Okay.
We just last week we had a patient who we did a right hemicolectomy as a patient with CA, cecum and tuberculosis.
Yeah.
Yes.
Now actually he's on tuberculosis, Now the oncologist say, you know, the oncology, medical oncology, we do, but the tuberculosis, you go back to Radha Krishna, he'll deal with it. Anyway, my physician, gastroenterologist, they're there because the problem is these people has to be very closely monitored for any liver dysfunction, gastritis, yeah, and so on and so forth, which since they have the facility of good physicians around, so I'll just leave it to them. They also enjoy doing that. Yes, sir.
Any postgraduate, can you present this case capsule? Just unmute so that it's a practice for you.
Yeah, Dr. Mahesh, yes.
Sir, during the pre-op ATT, is there any criteria of the interval between the pre-op ATT and surgery, sir?
See, it is like this.
Or
at least 7 to 10 days, at least.
Okay.
There is at least, because it's a very tricky question which you asked, because these are the patients who have come to the hospital with the there is a diagnosis of tuberculosis. They may be in a partial obstruction. I mentioned that if you have got the tissue diagnosis also, and whether to treat them, and this is not the patients whom you put ATT and send home. No. These are the patients who are having the palpable mass, subacute obstruction, some kind of a picture. But I mentioned, if you are able to get a diagnosis of a tuberculosis, start the ATT and at least 7 to 10 days and then take the patient.
Sir, and then secondly, sir, your experience on CBNAT in preoperative ascitic fluid aspiration, sir, at the time of diagnosis?
Oh, no. Not much.
So can we do it with the ascitic fluid aspiration, sir? CBNAT, is there any usefulness, sir? If the diagnosis is in dilemma?
Usually it is mentioned, but tissue is more important. Tissue.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Okay.
Whether it's a sinus tract pus there or a wall biopsy or a lymph node or whatever, right?
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Can you present this case? Same person who asked this question. Don't mind presenting. Not difficult case. Yes.
Sorry, sir. I'm in ICU duty, sir. Just I was listening for this afternoon.
Sorry.
Mahesh, can you present this case? You just read it.
No problem.
Anyone else?
It's
Keshav.
A 23-year-old female waiting for fecalian discharge from open surgical site in 6 months, minimal in quantity of around 10 to 15 ml per day, no history of abdominal distension, no history of abdominal pain, no history of fever.
So it's a post-appendicectomy, something coming from there. It's called as fecal fistula. Look at that 6 months duration, 6 months. But what is coming is very less. So it's obviously low output fistula. There's no distension, no pain, no fever. Look at that weight, it's 45 kg. So don't expect every fistula means to have a lot of contents. It was very small content. In fact, she said, I'm passing the some mustard. You know the size of the mustard. Mustard comes out from there. That's what she says. So these are some other causes. Can you read these causes?
Anemia,
persistent fistula. Yeah.
Anemia, all three of seriousness of disease, drugs, steroids, diabetes.
There's some disturbance, doesn't matter. I just want to ask you, post appendectomy fecal fistula means what are the things which you take into consideration when I say seriousness of the disease? This. Okay, I think what I'm trying to tell is every patient who has a fecal fistula does not mean that these patients are having actinomycosis or a carcinoma. Because the most common question which is asked is post-appendicectomy fistula, what is the cause? Answer given is actinomycosis. So please get that from your mind. It could be a technical issue here. Gangrene might have gone in the cecum. So that might have been responsible for obstruction, distal obstruction, including tuberculosis, elderly people malignancy, apart from the sutures, so surgical issues. So that is what you should keep it in mind, right? So she came like this with the colostomy bag, right? So that's how we so. And this is what I already mentioned to you. Post-appendicectomy enterokinase fistula. These are the various diagnosis. So now, what do you want to do? Can you tell me now, what do you want to do? You are there? Yes.
Yeah, sir.
Yeah, sir, he's there, sir.
What is the sir is asking a question? Can you reply?
Yeah, sir.
Tell. How do you investigate? Maybe.
Exploratory.
Anyone else who can answer? Yeah. Please go, Keshav. You have gone.
I can't hear you. I think I'm not sure. I myself will proceed now. I know. So what, I don't know whether you wanted exploratory laparotomy. I heard something EX like that. Doesn't matter. So we have time now. Only 5 ml, 10 ml come. So you get an ultrasound done. They said some inflammatory action, prominent loops, etc. There is a fistula there. So you can do a CT fistulogram. That should be your answer. That is the fistula. You can directly goes into the dye, goes into the can. You may be able to get a where is the diagnosis, where is the leak. We know that it is a post appendicectomy. These are some pictures. You can see some white thing there. This is the area. So you can see here small tracks. See. So I wanted you to remember two things for this case. The reason I got is one is post-appendicectomy fecal fistula, don't say actinomycosis. Consider tuberculosis one of the possibility. Second is CT fistulogram. It showed two tracks. One goes to the cecum and ascending colon, and second was going into the behind, near the quadratus lumborum. Now, we also did a colonoscopy and biopsy. Just look at that. They put this question mark. TB bar Crohn's colitis. So, we had a colonoscopy also. And when this was done, that CBNAT was not there. So we did not venture in to take a diagnosis of tuberculosis and start ATT. So we did an exploratory laparotomy. There were some difficulties like mobilization of the colon, etc. But we were able to get it to a limited colectomy. And ileotransverse was done. And patient became all right. So I put this slide not for you to read total, but just to whenever a pathology report is given, but have a look at once. That's the way you learn. See the Langhans type of giant cells, granulomas, no crypt abscesses. Same people who gave a diagnosis initially, query TB, query Crohn's. Now they give that. That happens. Central area of necrosis, but there's something here. One lymph node is positive for AFB. So it's the acid fast bacilli is positive. So the diagnosis is tuberculosis. She was put on ATT and she became all right. So just to conclude that tuberculosis is a major problem. We have a lot of diagnostic challenges in India. Lots of surgeons are having enough number of experience with the tuberculosis. So the experience cannot be substituted by any of these investigations or even for that matter, the textbooks. But we should keep it in mind the diagnosis in Indian scenario when we say, you know, tummy is distended, some various some weight loss, even increase of temperature, complications are important, operation as well as obstruction. And ATT, you know, the ATT as well, their side effects. More number of HIV cases, atypical bacteria to be kept in mind, especially when, very important here, AFB is positive but gene is negative. So it should be kept in mind because their treatment is not only rifampicin, clarithromycin also. So these are few of the references, and I'd like to say thank you. And if you have any questions, I'll take the questions. Please unmute and ask.
Yeah, this is just a word of caution for the postgraduates, especially when one is doing a routine appendicectomy, usually a laparoscopic one, or even an open one. It's always advisable for the PGs to, after the appendix has been removed, to cover or the wrap the stump or that area with omentum. That is found to be significantly reduced the fistula rate, if it's a technical issue which has led to a fistula. The second important thing about appendicectomy is trace the primary histopathology report. Many times we tend to neglect, arey wo acute appendix tha. And then after 3 months or 4 months, the patient comes with a fistula, and then we start searching where we can't really get the evidence. That's number two. And number three, which I found very difficult to understand. Traditionally, we were always taught in second MBBS that epithelioid cells, or epithelioid cell is the pathognomic cell of TB. But now, unfortunately, pathologists totally disagree with this concept. And they say, fine, epithelioid cell may not always be there because it is found in many other places. Now, in the capsule which you presented, the initial thing showed epithelioid cells. So again, I am of the school of thought that if you see epithelioid cells, the clinical scenario fits into tuberculosis. I think there is no harm in starting empiric AKT, which was once upon a time the traditional teaching when we were residents. What is your opinion about this empiric AKT based on epithelioid cells? And they resolve. They do well. Those patients do well.
I know, sir. But then looking at the toxicity of ATT, and if one patient goes for a hepatotoxicity, legally you are sued. So
yeah, that is the main
because
problem.
They say the non-caseating granuloma, non-caseating granulomas found in Crohn's disease also. So in other diseases also, epithelioid cells. In our patient, they put as TB bar Crohn's. So obviously we are stuck, and they give necrosis like that. Great imitator.
Yeah, I am Dr. Ashok here. I have a question from Dr. Sinai. In the last case capsule, you said there was a low output fistula after appendicectomy, and you have the evidence of ATT, tuberculosis by doing colonoscopy and biopsy. I could have gone for ATT trial for a couple of months rather than going straight for surgery.
No, sir, there was no evidence of tuberculosis. After the colonoscopy, they put I'm showing the slide. Acute granulomatous colitis, TB bar Crohn's colitis.
So even with this histopathological report, I could have gone for ATT. The other thing is we could have collected the pus and sent it for PCR, that or AFB culture or AFB stain. So there are a lot of things that could have been done. Anyway, even with this report,
done, sir, all have been done. PCR has been done. It has the AFB culture have been done, but then everything was negative, except this was the finding they gave, the diagnosis.
Yeah, even with this finding,
another thing which led. Yes, sir.
Even with this finding, given a trial of a month of tuberculosis with this plus minus histopathology, I think the operation could have been avoided. I don't know. This my take.
I'm not trying to say that this is the we discussed this reports in our forum, and two things came out of this. One is about the legal issue, and that is in case because she's a young girl, and second was there were two tracks in this patient. I think in the CT scan I have shown you one track was going behind into the retroperitoneum, another was going to the ascending colon. So whether the tracks would have persisted, I do not know. That's why I asked that's why I said tuberculosis thing, you know, experience also matters. Based on these two findings, our colleagues decided that you open this patient. That is the reason we open patient.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Any other questions? Okay.
So there are no more questions, sir. Yet another wonderful lecture. Beautiful slides, and then it's a complete lecture. Thank you so much.
Radha Krishna, you have any opinions related to this kind of anecdotal cases, you know, little tricky abdominal cocoons or fistula post appendiceal?
I mean, we've seen the entire gamut of abdominal tuberculosis, and we see these patients quite often. Quite a few times we land up in trouble as to how to proceed. There are sometimes when we go for a laparotomy, we see multiple bowel openings in multiple places. When the application of bags will become a problem. But I also see that the majority of these people respond dramatically to anti-tuberculosis treatment. If you can get the ATT in at the right time, they dramatically respond. And even they put on anything up to 20 kilos, 30 kilos easily. I mean, this is one particular disease I think we should not ignore, and we should go with the management. Correct. Of the stoma will become a problem. And again, when, as you rightly said, when you have a patient with obstruction with the proximal perforation, that's when the problem comes, because all the balls will be stuck to each other. Cocoon is another difficult area, especially when it comes with the ball obstruction or ball perforation. But then I think a lot of Indian surgeons are so accustomed to operating in abdominal tuberculosis, they find some way or the other to. So, but these people, they survive. And we have our own methods of feeding them. And we generally involve our ID and our nutritionist from the very beginning, which they very closely follow. The only issue comes up with giving oral ATT, because there are no good injectable ATTs. And when these people have fistula, proximal wall fistula, giving orally is a bit of a problem. That's one place we don't have a consensus, but the patient can take medication orally, but there's nothing like it. And this, after all, we have had issues of patients with HIV with abdominal tuberculosis, because non-pulmonary tuberculosis increased suddenly with HIV, but luckily HIV is coming down, so we hope even this tuberculosis is also, extrapulmonary tuberculosis also will come down.
Thank you.
Anyway, yours is a wonderful lecture, sir, very complete and comprehensive. Like, I know how much time you spend on making each of these lectures, because if I had to make, it's going to take a lot of time, because you need to get all the points in a certain manner, and your slides are very good. The pattern, the way the font, the whole layout is so very good. So people get addicted to your lectures.
Thank you,
Dr. Chheda. Congratulations.
Yeah,
it was an excellent lecture. It was very nice to see you after quite some time, because unfortunately we couldn't meet because of this COVID pandemic this year. So let's hope we meet next year. When everything is normal. Excellent lecture, excellent slides, and indeed a very good refresher with a good discussion with yourself and Dr. Radhakrishnan as well. Excellent lecture.
So thank you, sir. Shenoy, sir, and we'll see you again coming Monday with another lovely lecture.
Surely. Great.
Thank you.